affects us moving forward in the second year of budget. As you know, we agreed the 3-year budget last year. This is the second year, so it's a question of moving forward. But I want to talk just through the increase in the council tax by 5.8%, but also talk to you about other things as well. Let's just see if we can click it. Okay, I think it's important, I hope everybody can see around the chamber. Just before I start the presentation and give you on where we are, I think it's right, fit and proper that we thank Peter Casterton and all the team in finance that are here for the work that they've done in managing the budget process, not just since 2017, but up to today. We constantly need reminded that we actually ask our council officers to do much, much more with less. So I really do appreciate, Peter, the work and that you and your team and everybody that has gone. And I'm sure you've made yourself available to opposition groups as well, if they so required. So thank you for that. I've had conversations just recently with the staff, all the staff of the council. I had meetings on Monday, two sessions, one on Monday morning and one on Monday afternoon, with all of the staff of the council to talk to them, not just about the budget, but about the local growth plan and what the next chapter means for our city. It's great to see members of Jay Tucker at the back there, our trade union colleagues, and I appreciate all you do in supporting us in terms of budget terms and your contribution with me. It was a good meeting today, again, talking about the way forward and how we manage things. I always start the AGM, the budget sessions, with saying to all of the staff of the council, please join your trade union, please be part of your trade union, because it's important that they represent you and be able to speak as your voice. Okay, I also, at this juncture, and it was interesting to see my colleagues who retired, and Tim talked about, and Rachel talked about, financial challenges that we faced in particular since 2010. And it's important that we put in context exactly why we've made decisions that we've made and why we are things the way we are going to do over the next period, the next chapter. It's absolutely vital that people understand. I often refer to it when I grew up. From 1958 onwards, I remember as a young lad and then a teenager walking around the street from where I grew up. And often when it was raining or snowing or anything went wrong, everyone blamed the corpy. And the corpy is, of course, the council. It was always them and the corpy there to blame. And we have to, I think, and it's a big, big challenge, but it's actually about explaining to people what the responsibilities of the corpy are and what the finances we have as the corpy and what we can spend and what we can do. And that's what we've tried to do, explain to people so they understand and not criticise the things that we do, but understand the reasons why we have to do them. It comes back to Tim's point before, about explaining to people on the doorstep and talking to people. So it's important that we look at and remind ourselves about what happened in 2010 when we took control of the city. And of course you'll see, I've mentioned them before, and I make no apologies for mentioning them again, that we had a £17 million overspend in adult social care, 11 in children's services, £22 million bill for capital culture, £67 million status equal pay, which cried out for us to sort out, but indeed nobody, no political will from the previous administration to sort. So £100 million of unpaid bills, what we inherited. I hear people talking about the 80s and the wonderful period and era of the 80s when so much was happening. Well, we built more schools than ever was built in the 80s by the previous administration, Labour administration. We built more houses than the previous administration did. And we've, of course, protected our leisure services, our children's centres, our libraries more than at any other time in the council. So the fact that we are really proud of and something that we should be absolutely championing, that we've done that. And as I said, that's a massive blow to us. And I remember teachers and governors and parents talking to us about the plan built for their schools in their communities that was withdrawn. And of course, we promised that we'd pick it up, and we did. And so you can't drive out the city now without seeing a new school. And there's around about 20,000 kids, 20,000 children in new schools, new facilities that we've built. We often always hear from, and recently you'll have picked this up, with, and I'll come to it a little bit later on in the presentation, about the Brandymore Dock and Everton Football Club, and you'll hear the Lib Dems talk about borrowing, and how we are being, spend the money that we haven't got and do the things that we haven't got. So of course, it's important really, just for people, and in particular people who want to criticise us, to actually look at these active figures and put them up there. I'm going to probably make sure that we put out a leaflet in Lib Dem sort of wards to remind people of what was left, what we've got still today. It's amazing, isn't it? Absolutely amazing. Look at that, what we've got to pay. Parkland High School is closed, but it cost us £4 million a year. It's empty. It's what the Lib Dems left us. £175 million schools, PFI. That's what we still have to pay today. £59 million for Central Library. £2 million for the next 25 or 28 years, I think it is. £12 million for Wayne Retreat Aquatic Centre. We're still paying £2 million. All adds up to £300 million in debt. But the difference between my approach or our approach as an administration is what we do is called invest to win. And we're bringing in revenue. Revenue that's helping the city move forward and pay for services. That's a millstone around my neck every year in budgets. We have to set aside £11 million to actually put into the budget to pay for that borrowing. So it's not borrowing as an investment, it's borrowing as a millstone around the people of this city's neck. And you know, not once, for instance, of the Liberal Democrats come to me and said, we've got a solution for Parkland's job. Would you like to talk to us about it? Well, when we're looking about the investment that we're doing around Calderstones, in terms of the, not forget about the mansion and what we paid, but the proposal to build houses, probably around about less than £6 million we'll get for the site or whatever, but the vast majority of the money for that site is going to be invested in a new facility for Beatley Ryan Stables, about £2 million. And for Calder Kids, around about £1.7 million. The bottom line is, nobody comes to me and says, don't do that job because we've got a solution on how you can fund those new facilities. Don't do that at all. So you know, they leave us with debt and make no contribution at all, and no budget amendments today from them, not even set the budget, you won't know what they're here for. But not at all, no suggestions. So when we then look at what we've got to do, and it's just helpful just to remind you of that. I know people enjoy just getting told about what we've inherited. I enjoy telling you. look at the second year of our budget, and we look at the £90 million that we've had to find. Now, look, the bottom line is, you know as well as I do, that this government, for the last short period of the time, in the 8 years that we've been in power, for the most of that period, were aided and abetted by the Liberal Democratic movement that continued to smash the city in an unprecedented way in terms of taking funds away from us. But by 2020, the city is going to be in a really serious position, because I don't know whether the fair funding review formula that comes from government, or if it's going to come up with one, is going to help the city, or whether we're going to be totally dependent after 2020 on ourselves. So, you know, we have to, as I say, get to a situation where we grow the economy, we grow our council tax base and our business base, but at the same time, protect the vulnerable. That's just an example of the funding cuts and budget gap since 2010. So if you look at it, that's what we've had to do, £420 million. Wouldn't it be nice to have that £420 million to spend? And that's what you've got to remember. You know, the Liberal Democrats in the city and the Labour government provided the money, but they decided to cut, and I'll show you a slide in a minute, they decided to cut the council tax, play politics with the council tax, which has left us with about a £200 million shortfall in the base budget, and around about £20 million a year that we've actually lost as a result of them gerrymandering the figures to try and win votes. Remember the 5% cut, I'll come to that in a minute. But just to give an example of the challenges that we face, as you can see there, when I talk about our council tax base, the challenges that we face is Liverpool properties are all, the majority, 60%, are in the lowest council tax bands. And if you look at Sefton, Neighbour and Sefton, only 31%, and Bristol, 26%. So that actually means that Bristol, which is a smaller population by 30,000 less than in Bristol than in Liverpool, they actually get £38 million more in council tax than we do. And of course it means that with us having the lowest, you know, or the highest number of properties in the lowest council tax bands, it means that, for instance, when we put up the council tax by 1%, we bring in now about £1.4 million, and in Surrey it's £6 million. And of course that means that where you've got Surrey with very little social inequalities or problems that they face, they only have to put up the council tax a small amount, and they get a better revenue return, a better income than we do. As I said, this is something that I've just mentioned. It's £205 million. People need to understand about the base budget. When that's cut the council tax, but also had a zero increase in council tax for 3 years, inflation was running around about 2.7%, 3% or whatever, and the figure meant that we wouldn't get the money in to pay for services, and the council tax was reduced. So the base budget of the council tax hasn't been added to every year. So if you take it from the 2003 and 1990 to 2003, when they did that, it's meant now that we're actually £19.5 million a year short, that we would have that in. And of course, if we had that, we wouldn't be talking about the need to increase council tax or put up the council tax in any way, shape or form. That was the irresponsibility of gerrymandering the figures and the funding to actually win votes. It's important that you see these slides as well, because if you look at the number of properties that we've increased, and this is the point about building more properties under this administration than any previous administration, you'll see 11,403 properties being built, and that's meant a £13.2 million increase in council tax. Now, that's something that we should be absolutely applauded for, because not only are we providing the old, but we're bringing in the revenue. And in addition to that, you'll see our investor here has brought in around £14 million, making just under about £28 million in new revenue for the city every year because of a Labour administration in the city. And that's an important point for you to understand as well. And then when we look at the budget, this government, in a perverse way, continuing on from the coalition, has continued to do what it always did. That was pass forth the responsibility onto councils, but at the same time reducing the funding. And so we come to the 5.8% increase in council tax. And you need to understand that the city needs to understand, people need to understand exactly what is going on and what has happened. And of course, when we took control in 2010, £222 million used to be what we spent on adult social care. £222 million today is around about £172 million. So you can see that massive cost. And of course, we've had to pick up the pieces. We've had to pick up the support and trying to keep social workers and other people. So the 5.9% is 3% that is ring-fenced for adult social care. And that is, of course, what I've just said to you. The government passing on the responsibility to us, that will reduce the funding, so we've got to make that shortfall. So we've got to put up the council tax by 3% in order just to keep up with inflation, which is running at 3%. So bear that in mind as well. And then 1% for children's social care as well. And we've got an overspend in children's social care as we speak of just under £8 million. So you can see the challenges as more and more people in the city, parents, children with special needs, children with disabilities, children in need of specialised education or accommodation. And yet we're over budget by around about £8 million. That's a massive, massive problem for us that we need to fix. So if you look at the fact that we've also got to pay our staff 2%, I wish there could be more, but we've got to pay 2%. We set aside prudently 1% for that. There's another 1%, which means that there is less than 1% to come into what we call the general fund to pay for services. So less than 1% is what goes in to help us pay for street cleansing, the libraries, street seed, all of the things, looking after the parks, all of the things that we want to do, less than 1%. And as I just said to you, inflation is running at 3%. So you can see that for the city in providing services, it's not a really good position to be in. Okay, and that basically is a slide that I want people to get to talk about and get to know. I'll tell you in a minute about the 66,000 people a year that this city helps. 66,000 people a year our city helps, and without us helping them, they wouldn't be able to cope. And I'll give you some more information in a second, but that's the amount that we pay towards helping people in terms of the citizen support scheme, and all the things that we do compared to anybody within the region. And so, as I said, there's just information there about the public sector pay rise and less than 1% coming to us. So, you know how massively we've been hit, we've lost. We've lost 3,000 staff since 2010. We've cut levels of middle management. We've cut performance-related bonuses. We've cut councillors' expenses. We've cut special responsibility allowances. Well, by the way, just incidentally for the... thank Councillor Makinson so much for this campaign about officers' cars, that's now stopped, I've written to them. But free cars, when, here's someone saying yes, when you were in charge, not only cars you used to provide to the officers. You just laughed. Cars you used to provide.
Answer the question.
It was a different era.
It's the same as Margaret Thatcher's statue and me saying about fresh fries. It's a different era and it's a different thing. 17 councillors' cars and £5 million paid to officers in performance related pay. And do you know who got rid of it? Who got rid of it? Jolly Joe. Jolly Joe got rid of it. So laugh on that. That's the issue. Look, £5 million performance-related pay went, and we cut all of those things, including the 17 cars. 17 cars? Don't forget cars when they set up the joint ventures. I remember, I can give you of two officers who went across into the joint ventures, and they both got brand new BMWs. Previous administration, all high model, fiber, and put down your leaf with them. Okay, our priorities. I'm told you every year, and I tell people every single year about what our priorities are. And what our priorities are is to grow and to protect people. And I'm going to give you examples of how we've done both of those things. Okay, I said to you before about the things that we spend our money on and what we do. And I told you about the fact that we help 66,000 people within the city who are finding hard to cope and really difficult. So let me just tell you a little bit about that, because we could stop this today. There's no statutory requirement for us to pay this money. Not at all. And indeed, some of the councils don't pay it, don't do it, don't support people. They actually don't do it. But we do. £50 million a year we spend on protecting the most vulnerable. And of course, you know that if we actually didn't do that, that would give us £60 million clear profits and we wouldn't have a budget deficit. We'd have £60 million to spend on. But this is the difference. That's not why I wanted to be mayor or a councillor, and neither is it your reason for wanting to be. Because your principles and your values are the same as mine, and that is to help those most in need, but to do it in a responsible way by growing our economy, and that's what we're doing. Council tax support, 25.7 million, and that's why in the new chapter, in the new company that we're setting up, the homes, our new housing company, we are going to have a commercial arm and a social arm, and that's going to help reduce that council tax support bill by making sure instead of that money being spent to RSLs or to the private sector, it actually comes back into us. So we get a double hit, we save money there, we get a rent, or we get a rent if we're just directly renting it, or if we're selling it. So we get a council tax, a rent, and plus we save money on housing benefits. But that's what we're currently paying, £11 million to support the homeless, the Laboratory Centre. You've seen all of the things that we're doing. The discretionary housing payments. No other city in the country spends more support and helping people with discretionary housing payments than we do. That money, that £25 million, that's directly paid for from us. The government withdrew that money, but we still spend supporting people to stay in their houses so that they're not evicted and put out in the streets by private landlords or by anybody else. That's why we spend it. The crisis payments, what we do, 3.1 million benefits maximisation. Martin Jungowitz and his team do a fantastic job. People in this city who are in poverty and need more help. The hardship fund to help people. That's £50 million
from a proud socialist council delivering for the people of this region. There's 11 million on services for people who find themselves often. 750 beds in hostels. People don't even know where they are. I could point the finger at people in this chamber about do they know where our hostels are? And I bet you couldn't answer me.
House, and then there's the money that we support to transform our choices, the money that we give to all of the premises, like for instance Salvation Army, that supports the Whitechapel Centre that we support, all of those organisations that we actually help and support and fund. And then Ladbury House, one of the only facilities in this country like it, where we don't only provide accommodation, but we provide support and help for people to move on, providing hope for people so that they only get just help with the benefits, but they get help and direction and support to get off addiction, support and help to get into employment, support and help to medical advice and support, being able to contact the families and a safe place to stay. Irrespective of where you come from, irrespective of what race you are, what colour you are, or what country you come from. Private, confidential support, something that we're proud of, and something that we'll keep doing, and it'll get stronger and better. And since we've increased our support to people who are being sanctioned, we've seen people come to us begging for support, because they're going to get evicted, or going to get the gas turned off, or the electric turned off. And we step in here with the Citizen Support Scheme, and we help people. And that's because of universal credit and the sanctions regime from the Tories in power. Absolutely appalling welfare reforms that are hitting people really hard. And so, as I said, 9,100 people have been helped since we set up the discretionary housing payment. 70% are from people in terms of who've been affected by the bedroom tax. So, you know, there you go, 11,500 people have been helped with crisis payments. These are people appealing for us to help. Crisis payments for food, for heating,
for gas.
11,500. And as I said, the benefits maximisation and advice and support, we're investing 1 million annually in benefits maximisation, creating new people, new staff to help people because the demand has grown. Okay, you also know that we've put into the neighbourhoods, into the wards, extra money for people to help. I believe that's been desperately used and we need more. We'll be looking at how we can help. Then, you know, we look at what we've done. I mentioned it before about the number of libraries closed. You see, figures there, 450 across the country, none here. 350 children's centres, none here. We work with our partners and work with communities. William Pound, as I said, into credit unions, the mayor's discretionary fund, helping local groups, the food banks that get support from the mayor's own fund. We give out meat parcels and veg parcels over the Christmas period, which went down really well. Okay, then, this is a couple of slides that I just wanted to, and then I'll talk to you a little bit. Council kept busy reading there, but might be an interesting few slides to hear from him, because he said that there was no investment coming into the city. Leave that up there just for a second for you until you get your head around that. Because that's a growing economy. It's looking at, if you look at it, it's over £1 billion.
pound, £1.4 billion has been spent in the city. Look at it. Since 2015, over £1 billion every single year. More than that proposed. Absolutely fantastic growth. Actually, if you like, when we, let me show you this slide. It's 1.4 billion that's currently on. It's actually happening. 12,000 construction jobs. 5,000 new homes currently being built. 14 billion worth of steam still to come. That's over the 2.5-3 years. That's a massive amount of money being spent. And then let's look at this one about the arcade. Is that, there's a crisis in investment and stuff, whatever. I know a lot of people who are outside more professional and knowledgeable than him. In fact, I know literally millions of them. But Arcadis have put down a report, and Arcadis talk about Liverpool as one of the top four hotspots for growth, ahead of London, Birmingham and Manchester. Isn't that funny? A bit different than the Council of Accounts prediction there. And again, when I want to take sort of information from him, you take it with a big pinch of salt. But let me just go on to show you a couple of other things about what our investments have done in the city. And it is, you know, we've safeguarded jobs. That's often overlooked about the number of jobs that we've protected, you know, with the tobacco warehouse, all of the things that we've done, the Loft Hotel, all of the things, including the airport investment, about protecting jobs. And so I thought, well, let's just give a few. I'm being really serious now, and you know, I know it's only just 10:06. I could talk for another hour and a half on regeneration and projects and growth within the city, but I'm just going to give you a little snapshot, Councillor Mulvey, before you raise it. I thought, you know, we've created Paddington Village, which is 30 acres, unprecedented Royal College positions. A language school moving in there. We're going to be making some announcements tomorrow morning and some announcements in Mipham. It's the knowledge quarter. It's about life sciences and growing research. Working alongside our universities, School of Tropical Medicine. As I said, we've got the Royal College of Physicians that have chosen Liverpool ahead of many other cities to locate here and develop on that particular site, which is going to, it's over £1 billion scheme that's going to create thousands of jobs, and it's going to be linked to the Royal Liverpool Teaching Hospital, the University Hospital, if Canelia never get on with it. And that's why, you know, this week in terms of the Knowledge Quarter Master Plan is going to be procured. You'll see the transformation of Lime Street. We can talk about the rail development zones around the waterfront. Why we're investing over £100 million in the 10 streets, the Baltic Triangle. That's why we're going out this week to procure the new roads for the waterfront to connect that to the Isle of Man. Brand new terminal being built by the Isle of Man, and new ferries coming in next to the cruise liner terminal, which is going to happen. It goes to plan shortly with the design on that particular building. And that's just the start. Things are going to be presented to us very, very shortly about the development of the festival park and how that's going to be a world-class leisure attraction. It's why we're setting up the company, the housing company foundations, a massive opportunity for there. That's why we're talking about the King's Dock and the development of the plans around the King's Dock. There's lots of things, the Pall Mall site that's going to be developed. Major investments taking place, a major opportunity for us. And we'll be announcing some new things, not only over the next few days, but the next couple of weeks as well. So it comes back to the point about the twin track approach, about growing our economy and supporting people as we move forward. So when you look at the money that we've generated, as I said before, in terms of new businesses and new housing, you'll actually see that we couldn't survive without that. So it is absolutely the right approach to make in terms of growing our economy. And then I just want to pick up on a couple of things around the borrowing. It's something that seems to be interesting, Councillor Bacon, you know, about his leaflets and how he looks at things. So I thought, well, why can't we, let's just have a look at our borrowing. And remember the point I said to you before about them borrowing 300 million themselves and leaving us with the debt, and our borrowing generates an income and provides a revenue. I thought, well, let's have a little look at what is the debt of others compared to Liverpool. And you'll see, obviously Birmingham's bigger than us, but you'll see the debt that they've got compared to ours is four times the amount of debt that they've got. Leeds, you'll see, 1,196,000,000 external debt. Manchester, very, very similar to ours. Newcastle, Sheffield. So we're nowhere near. And if you look at Warrington, which is not the size of us, have got more debt than us. So nothing to be concerned about. And if you look at how councils have borrowed money to invest, there's a great example. Spellbourne Borough Council, 95,000 people lived there, and they're there, because of somebody pointed it out. But they've borrowed 360 million. So you know, when you look at what we're borrowing, our borrowing is prudent borrowing that brings us a return, and that's what we'll continue to do. So I just want to then, because it's important, I think if this clicker works, as I said, that our borrowing generates income to pay for services. That's why we do it. That's what it's all about. But I just wanted to just talk about the invest to earn, and you'll see some comments again made by the detractors and the mockers. I'm talking about the students and one over there who talked to us about, just for instance, the Everton proposals. And we've seen there's one of our friends over there from the Echo Council, Kent Schmidt, who attacked us the other day about not disclosing information from SIPFA. So you all have heard me talk many, many times at this council and other meetings, and at Capitalist and other public meetings, including the esteemed journal, The Echo, who reported what I've said, is that there will be no deal done with Everton until it's been fully scrutinised and looked at. And then Capsule Kemp, in his wisdom, I don't know where he finds the time, flights to Madagascar or whatever, he goes on behalf of LGA or UCLG or whatever, flying around the world. He's done more air miles than Alan Wicker did. He's done more in 1 year than Alan Wicker ever did. But he found time to comment. He found time to comment and say that we were trying to hide and aid the better by the Echo. Talking about we were trying to hide a simple report. It wasn't even a report. We had negotiations. You remember I told you about we were getting asked to securitise a loan by Everton with the private sector. You remember I talked about it? And I actually said to you in this chamber that what we were doing was looking at whether, instead of us securitising the loan and a private sector company lending the money, we'd look at doing it ourselves. And that's what we've been doing for the last 11 months. So, Ernst Young, SIPFA, Grant Thornton, a QC specialising in these type of projects, and Uncle Tom Dickey and Annie and Uncle Tom Cobley and all the district auditors, they're all looking at it. And 11 months ago, we had one proposal, and now we've got a different proposal, because we've been negotiating back and forward with different people. And that's right and proper, and I've always made it absolutely clear
that Sidbeth, aged young, the district auditor, and Uncle Tom Codley and all would all be satisfied that we've got security in place and the deal is the right deal for Liverpool. I couldn't be any more clear than that, I've said it. But of course, the echo in their wisdom with Mr. M want to smear it as a cover up. Well, I spoke to Sidbeth. Sidbeth said to me, they know full the deal that we've got today. It's completely different than the proposal that it was 11 months ago. And then Councillor Kemp said, look, you shared that with Everton. Why can't I see it? Well, you're not going to see it because it is a commercial deal that we're negotiating. And it's right that Everton see it. And it's right that we see what Everton have got. And about how we negotiate now we work things through. So, I mean, please. I remember the LDL contract, and what I said about the LDL contract. I'd bring it back in-house, and we'd scrutinise it, and we'd make sure that before we could bring it back in-house, we'd get value for money. The same way, we brought all our services back in-house anyway, we're proud of that. But what we did, we'll set up a scrutiny panel, and there'll be a scrutiny panel set up to look at the Everton deal. But the final scrutiny will be made by you, Councillor Kemp, and his colleagues there, and everybody else in the council. It'll go through water and finance, it'll go through regeneration, it'll go through cabinet, and finally it'll come back here. But we'll also set up, if you want to participate in it, a scrutiny panel to look at the deal as well, an all-party scrutiny panel, if Councillor wants to join that panel, or the Greens, in name and also number, want to join the panel as well. We'll have that. So everybody gets to see the deal. But there is absolutely no way that our city can actually continue to pay, sustain and support its services without actually doing things like Finch Farm, like the canal, like the airport, like the things that we're doing to grow the economy and to grow our tax base in terms of housing and our business base. Because I keep telling people, it's all right for political opportunists to have a go, but I keep telling people, and this is the point that the public need to understand, is that 2020, I don't know how we are going to manage to pay for services without us bringing in new revenue, and that's where we're at. Today, with an opportunity really, just for you to look at, on that, by the way, just wanted to talk to you a little bit about that. Important point to make about the Everton deal. Because we will be receiving over a 25-year period, if we've got the deal agreed, we will receive £7 million a year in clear profits. There will also be £1.4 million in business rates paid. And the repayments won't be made by us, it's made by Everton. So, with the security in place, if it's agreed by all the powers that be that scrutinise it and look at it, then it'll be a deal worthwhile doing, but it will only be approved by you when you've scrutinised it and seen all the details. But more of that is what we have to do. We simply have got no choice. If we don't invest to win and change how we do things, and that's what the local growth plan is all about. And that's why we need to start the new chapter about not only